the Naken.
Okay, clutch is really, really light. There's a dead space even in which the clutch stays stuck. Obviously the floor is wet, so the group ride will be slowed down a little bit for safety reasons. Clutchless lift is possible. This is not at all what you're looking into a review, but I want to get that person in front of me so I don't have to worry about whatever the F is happening behind me. Sounds nice. Feels very, very stable, even without hands. That probably is. But you can still drop it, have a traffic light. You can't park it, it doesn't have a park mode, it doesn't have a lock mode like MPA3s has. It is a motorcycle. It has a very, very small wheelbase up front. Alright, you're taking up ahead, also fine. That's actually what I wanted to do, but... also fine. Normally my bike would foot in between there. That's not possible in this one. Even though this bike is smaller than, for example, a GS 1200 or a Yamaha Tenerife with side boxes on it. So it isn't exactly wide, but it isn't as small as my old bike. Probably one of the best things about this bike is the fact that the mirrors are perfectly placed. It's the third time I'm riding this bike. First was on a motorbus, which was about 3 or 4 circles around a small lap, so not that much of time. Second time was at another Naken experience ride, and it's just the third time, and I have yet to touch the mirrors. They are always perfect. Something else that might be very important to learn about this bike is that the front steering system, which consists out of 3 parts, is guaranteed to last a lifetime. So any bearings or whatever is in there should last a lifetime. They say it will last forever, which is quite an interesting thing to say for a bike that's quite new. But it should mean that you should never have to touch any of this, which can be quite a pain in the ass to remove. Now of course you have 4 shocks up front, 2 for each tire. One is an actual shock, the other is a stabilizer. Those do need service, if only just for the oils. So you do need to, you know, maintain those. But that's normal work. Now the clutch is for me the main problem. It's just too light and there's too much wibbling room. So either change that when you buy one or get a aftermarket one. So there's a mild problem. The engine itself feels really, really sturdy and good and reliable. I think that's the main point. The engine feels reliable. It's of course an MT-09 engine. They did change the crankshaft, I think it was, for a heavy duty one, because this bike is quite a lot heavier than an average MT-09. But all! So you know, they did change a couple of things to make the engine reliable with this heavy weight. We do have cruise control, so there's this button on your steering wheel right there, next to the horn, then it becomes orange, and then with set, that is your cruise control speed. Now it stays at 74-ish. Now it stays at 70. Probably the best comparison between this and a normal bike would to be to jump on an MT-09, which I have, next to a very comfortable seat. It's mainly views that is the difference. It doesn't feel heavier. Obviously I can notice a difference between this bike and my bike, but my bike is probably quite a light one. So going from quite a light one to quite a heavy one, that's a big difference. Now for me, a test ride for a bike that I wanted to review consists of two things: trying as much as I possible can on said bike, so to a certain degree maybe even hooligooning it a little bit, but more importantly, let's try some uneven ground, nice, notice nothing, but more importantly trying to get a proper feel of the bike, but yet stay very safe, don't harm the bike. And I think that's an important little thing when test riding a bike. You should not try to hurt the bike. So you can't ever push it across your limits, because that would be a real shame if you drop the bike due to your pushing it too far. Now it's fun. I'm driving again behind the 69 bike. How can you make that up? Now, for all the technical stuff and details and whatnot more, I will make something fancy in screen. And the fun thing is, even on this uneven terrain, it still just glides. And that's of course because the fact that both tires can go up and down independently. So you can tackle a bump with one tire and stay straight with the other one, and you don't feel the bump in theory. Your rear tire will probably hit it, so you will definitely feel something, but you know. Okay, so this is the bump that you can take with one corner. Nah, you didn't really feel it. You felt that side going up a little bit, but it stayed straight and easy going. No big bump felt. My rear tire missed it, so my rear tire didn't also really got a bump. So in theory, what he said is true. That was me sliding on the wet tarmac. Okay, crawl down. What I noticed at that moment is how fast the bike refound its grip. I really dislike the fact that I didn't have a second camera to film the slippery that happened. And the weird thing is, it probably wasn't even the sliding away that, you know, got me by surprise. It was probably the re-gripping of the bike, just that little touch and it's back in place. That is what I felt. The downside is such a thing. The next couple of corners you do take unnecessary slow. I know where we are. I know it. Well, I don't think this is an all-around recommended bike. I think this is a bike that I recommend to test. Because if you're gonna like it, you're gonna like it. And when you really like this bike, it is quite a good bike to own. It can give you a little bit extra stability, a little bit extra confidence when riding. Does it fit? I bet it fits. Yeah, it fits. Nice. So it's not completely hopeless. And that shows you that it isn't as wide as it looks like. Nor does it feel as wide as it looks like. Okay, there's some interesting routes we're taking. It's mainly probably to test out or show the suspension. Because they aren't beautiful, nor are they many, many very interesting corners. However, with the rainfall today and yesterday, too many corners might not be the greatest idea as well. Even though you get a better way of feeling how the bike would handle and how much more or less grip it has, there's still, you know, some chance of maybe dropping the bike on the wet tarmac. and logically they want to prevent that. Okay, now in the group up front of me was 010 Rides. So the moment his video of this bike will come online, I will put it in the top comment on this video, and I will put it up in top here in screen. Let's try again. Set. Now it's set. So now I can ride without hands. This is amazing. And it feels very stable. It's like a tank plowing straight. Okay, now let's tackle this pump with all everything it got. Oh! Okay, you do come from your saddle. You do get launched. So, even though suspension up front is great, your rear will still kick you up. And we're still in mode 2, so I'll probably, you know, fuck it, change to mode 1 now. Mode 1 is the like this really sporty mode, the aggressive mode. I tried to avoid that early on because the road was still wet. But I have a feeling now that I'm a little bit more comfortable to the bike and the roads are a little bit drying up here and there, that I can try the mode 1, the more oomph mode. And it does have a difference in power. Get a little bit of headspace. There's the power. That wasn't too bad. Oh! Holy fucking dead bump. I did not anticipate nor saw that. Jesus, I felt that on my spine and my stomach. Holy fuck! Biggest downside being the clutch. Fuck that. Biggest downside being the rear suspension. Holy. I'm happy with cruise control on the clutchless lift, and there are many things that this bike is great at. But the either needs to be an adjuster for the rear suspension. So I will check that and I will film it and I will show you guys. Or that needs to be changed as soon as you buy this bike. And the clutch needs to be changed. Other than that, not much negativity to say about this bike. It isn't dead wide, it's still easy to lane split. Your mirrors are shorter than your steer, so you know, it isn't a very wide bike at all. It maneuvers very easy, high speeds, low speeds. All in all, it's quite a fun big bike. Haha! Man! Just cruising along. That's one of the things that a tour bike really should need. Cruise control. On the highway isn't great, so either a top part of that windshield or maybe an adjustable windshield. So for highway speeds, if you want to do long distances, change the windshield. So the GT has a different windscreen, better windscreen. Now on the highway with this speed, a little bit more difficult to correct the bike in cruise control, so sometimes you might need to put your hand on steering wheel, but still. Missed just the corner a little bit. I didn't get the step to the ground, but I did feel the ground with my toes. So yeah, end verdict. It's a fun bike, it's a big bike. For long distance is great, you're quite comfortable on the seat, you have the cruise control option which works great. But if you really want to do long distance highway, you probably need something to change the wind direction, because that isn't great at high speeds. Front suspension is a charm, like I said, it's work independently, so you don't feel much. Your rear is in this situation very stiff, so either adjust it or change it. The fact that the front tires independently can turn and can speed up independently from each other makes cornering very smooth. So it has the same principle like a car has. Each tire has total freedom depending on the other one, or depending on the other one, which is great. This is probably the best way they could design this. Mirrors are great, or mirrors are amazing. The brakes are great. So yeah, all in all, not much to complain about. And its turn and circle is absolutely spot on. Okay, thank you, Motorstore Barendrecht.